guess that would have been March 7th. It is so good to have everyone gathered and worship together, especially on this Independence Day weekend. We come together celebrating the freedom that so many have sacrificed for us to have, knowing that we can gather here together in freedom because of that. My name is Reverend Darla Goodrich, and on behalf of First Christian Church, the whole family here, we want to welcome everyone who is joining us either by live stream or here in the sanctuary today. If this is your first time worshiping with us, we're glad of all the places you could have chosen to worship or be online this morning that you have chosen to join with us here, and I hope that this is a meaningful experience for you all. I give thanks that this morning we have Eileen Bowen here with us doing our music, our piano this morning. Richard Bowen is going to sing our solo later and also reading our scripture. And Dale Petrie is running our cameras and spent the last 2 weeks setting up a new live stream camera here in the sanctuary, so give thanks for them. Be sure to see Amber Rohr's Children Moment if you haven't seen that, another wonderful one about us being light for the world. And what a special thing to celebrate with our children and grandchildren, nieces and nephews. If you are worshiping with us online, feel free at any point during this live stream worship to share it on your own Facebook page if you'd like for others to join us this morning. For those who are viewing online, in response to requests about offering that may be sent, it can be mailed to the First Christian Church address by electronic banking or mail at 211 South Walnut Street right here in Crawfordsville, or dropped off at our secure mailbox right by the side of our office on Walnut. Offering trays are available to all in the sanctuary if you need use of them. They are by the exit door with the communion that you received this morning. This is going to be still, even as we are gathering together, a 30-minute service this morning, beginning with morning prayer and followed by a short offering time, then the scripture and message, concluding with music and then communion together, which I so look forward to this morning. Just a friendly reminder to wear your masks throughout the worship in order that all who attend can be assured they can count on their safety in this worshiping environment. If it does get uncomfortable, feel free to walk out into the area out just outside the sanctuary to take it off if you're having some struggle breathing, and you can come back in. We want a very relaxed atmosphere here. Today is the first day that we're using new cameras, and also the first day that we're worshiping in the sanctuary. We're going to continue to evaluate both of these, and we'll be making adaptations as we grow into new patterns. We'd love to hear from you, the worshiping community, including integrating PowerPoint information for both online and here in person in the sanctuary. I thank you for your patience. I will confess it's a little disorienting for me this morning to be talking to a sanctuary and a camera both, but we'll all adjust to that, and thank you for your patience, and I'm really excited about this new way that we are getting to learn how to worship together. With all that said, let us now prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. As I light the Christ candle today, may it remind us of the light of God's grace that frees us all to be light for the world. For those who are at home, won't you join us here in the sanctuary as we light the Christ candle? Old-fashioned method. Sometimes spirit and in truth. Before bowing our heads in prayer for those at home, will you now join me in placing your written prayers in your prayer basket or bowl, whatever you have at home? And for those that are here in the sanctuary, let us place all the concerns of our hearts in this moment, in the spirit of God's care, as we entrust our lives to God. Will you now join me in prayer? O Holy One, Creator of heaven and earth, we give you thanks for all the peoples and the nations of the earth who are beloved in your sight. As a people who have devoted ourselves to following the reconciling way of Christ, we pray today for this nation in which we dwell. We give thanks for all those who have fought and marched, had the courage to speak truth to power, and gave of themselves so that we as a nation might live more fully into the freedom that we cherish. May we be a people of humility and generosity and compassion. May the most vulnerable among us be a reminder that we still have work to do. May we serve your justice and mercy for their sake and for the sake of all. Instead of asking for your blessing first today as a nation, O God, we ask that you first enable us to be a blessing to the world, a light of hope, grounded in the way we live out our care for one another. We're reminded today, O God, of the scriptures where we are called to freedom, not as a means for self-indulgence, but through love in Christ are to become servants to one another, to love our neighbor as ourselves. Do not let our pride, Lord God, of country overwhelm the needs that still abound within our walls and our land. Where there is hatred, help us to bring your words of love. Where there are injustices, help us to correct unjust systems and become advocates for the voiceless and powerless. Where there is apathy, empower us to bring the good news of your gracious, transforming love. Be with all of us this day, with those we love and are concerned for, even as we pray for all, as Jesus taught us to do when he taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation,
deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So for those worshiping with us online, today in grateful response for the gift of true freedom that comes from God's grace and acceptance, let us now offer our time and our gifts and our resources so that others might know that same freedom as they too experience the love of Christ that invites us all to care for one another. And may those who are gathered in the sanctuary give in spirit, even as later we give in heart and in resources. Now won't you join me in putting your offering in the basket and our hearts and our lives in God's care. Will you join me in prayer? O most holy one, help us to remember that you freed us from ourselves for the sake of others who feel imprisoned by poverty or injustice or hopelessness. Enable us to be generous with all that we give of ourselves, so much so that the world might come to believe in your grace that sets us all free. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray these things. Amen. So, for those at home who have your Bibles out, if you will turn to Romans chapter 12, we're going to be reading verses 3 through 18. Before reading our scripture by way of background, Paul's letter to the church at Rome was likely written about 2 decades after Jesus' death and resurrection, around the year 50 to 55. Most common among scholars is the belief that this is a letter that was meant to be circulated among several churches and is possibly the single most important testament to Paul's overall theology, that we are justified, made whole by God's grace alone, not by our own works, and his emphasis on the unity and the purpose of the church, described as one body of Christ with many members. Let us now listen to one of the most significant chapters in this letter that focuses on these matters, as Richard Bowen now reads from chapter 12.
For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one with another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another, do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all.
Will you join me in prayer? Gracious God, we ask that you grant us the strength and the faith and the vision to be able to embrace that which will make for peace and freedom in our own lives and in this world you so love. Help us to hear your word beyond the limits of my words and any resistance there may be in our hearts, so that we might live our lives in the way of Christ. Amen. So I would say, over the past year or more, that at least that I can remember in the church, I've had folks ask me a number of times, more than ever, what does it really mean to be a member of the church? Perhaps because we don't talk about it enough these days, and maybe I need to be talking about it a little more. It's a really great question, which I often reply, well, do you mean being a member of the church universal, the church of all times and places, the church of Christ on earth? Like when we make our confession of faith to follow Jesus and to be baptized? Or are you referring to becoming a member of a congregation? One is kind of a big overarching picture, while the other is a grassroots expression, so to speak, of the larger reality and commitment that we make. It goes without saying it's a very deeply personal decision when we choose to follow Jesus. And yet, I cautiously say this because our confession of faith to follow Jesus, whenever we make that, is not just a personal decision, but also by its very nature is a communal commitment and a gift. No one would even know the message of Jesus if it hadn't been handed down from one community to the next. We are cradled in the faith by community. Because while following Christ for each of us, I know it is for me, it's very personal and unique, it is never individual. It assumes three kinds of belonging. First, that we belong to the world that God so loves, that Jesus died for, that we belong to our neighbors and our strangers and even enemies, that we belong to the body of Christ without which there would be no Christian life, no koinonia or communion with one another in Christ's name, no communion gathering around the table, and that we belong to a long tradition that proclaims good news that restores and reconciles, sets free and loves, all of which assumes relationships with others as essential to faith itself, grounded in the communal and the reconciling way of Jesus. Could any of us, I know I couldn't, could any of us even imagine any of Jesus' stories or teachings that doesn't lead to a restoration of relationships with God and others? Try to just imagine one. Could any of us imagine any of Paul's letters that aren't focused on the importance of community as the means through which faith is lived and practiced and grows, so that the world might believe that God's grace is possible? Could any of us imagine the good news without Jesus reminding us to remember, to come together, his own life when we do that, and his death and his resurrection? How would any of this be possible? The good news of Jesus Christ without gathering together as one body. We hear this today in Paul's letter to the church at Rome as he reminds the community what it means to be a member of the body of Christ, one of many, not one of one. Not just in the larger sense, but in the reality of everyday life, our everyday life, in the community of faith that we live with. He begins the section today reminding the early church that the Christian life is always rooted in community in order that we might together gain a proper self-understanding so as not to overvalue our self-importance or our individualism, which is so tempting these days. Not only for our own well-being, but for our community and our world. Even our own individual congregation really isn't separate or individual, but belongs to the larger body of Christ, even as we all experience it personally. Even our own individual congregation living out this lives us in a way that enables us to curb our temptation to take credit for is essentially what is God's gift. We are here because it is God's gift that gives us community. We are here to remember that God's grace can only be fulfilled when there's differing gifts lived out in a community. When we're able to demonstrate love for one another, even when we see things very differently or bring different gifts and understandings and have a variety of life experiences that we bring to this community. How else does Christ's love become real when everybody is getting along all the time or is all like-minded? What is the need for unity if everybody is the same? Where would the gospel be? The gift of community is precisely the great challenge it brings to grow together in our ability to love one another, not just in the easy times, but more importantly, in the difficult times in our life together and in the world. If we live only for our own faith, or our own perspective, or our own truth, then where would love be? Or what use would grace be? In other words, it seems to me anyway that membership is a commitment to a way of living that embodies the second great commandment, to love our neighbor as ourselves. It reminds me of Paul's words to the church at Galatia when he wrote saying to them, "You were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become servants to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." So I have to confess, from my vantage point, it's very difficult for me to imagine the life of faith without being a member of a congregation. After all, I was raised in the church. I don't ever remember not being surrounded by the church and with my parents being pastors. And thanks be to God, I've always been part of congregations who, through all the messiness of human relationships, taught me something about grace by how they lived together, how they worked out their differences together, how they served their community and sought first and foremost to love one another in spite of individual preferences or differences or opinions. This has been such a gift in my life, and why I trust God and answered the call to ministry. I know, and maybe you do too, and maybe you're someone who feels this way, there are those who understandably remain at a distance from church life because maybe they've been hurt by church or by a pastor somewhere along the way. Or maybe some have only been exposed to a message that suggests harsh judgment and is weak on hope or grace. Or some who maybe have never been to church and have only been exposed to a message that failed to preach any kind of meaningful transformation in life. Or just believe that being an individual Christian is going to be good enough. But you know, I think of all the people that I have met some through the years that have stumbled into congregations and I've grown to love, just looking for some meaning in the midst of the chaos in the world. I suspect most of us, whether we've been a member for a short time or we're just visiting or a long time, we're all looking for that meaning that holds us together in the midst of the chaos. Or there's people shopping around for churches looking for something that's going to give them something that maybe they don't even realize they already have. Value. Value. I think of the many youth groups I've worked with through the years. And of course, for those of you who've worked with youth, you know they often will bring friends or friends will just show up. Some friends who have no idea, never had any inclination that there might be a place in the world that actually really accepts them and honors them as a child of God who values their voice and honors their gifts, a place that will challenge them to grow into their best selves because of community and for the sake and the strength of the community and the well-being of the world. So what does it really mean to be a member of the church? I suspect I could do a whole series, and frankly, I wish this were an interactive sermon because I would love to hear from you about what you think that means. I suspect there's all kinds of new things I would hear, good things. To me, it means in our commitment to follow Jesus, we take seriously our membership in the body of Christ and that we belong to one another. It means we seek to find a community to give expression to that commitment in our lives, a place to be accountable to and for one another. It means that we'll be challenged by the diversity and the differences that community brings and invites, growing in our ability for patience and for love of one another. It means seeing our membership not as a member of an exclusive club, but a grateful belonging to an expansive grace that Jesus died for the whole world to have and know. Sometimes, and this is in conversations that I've had through the years, I think folks avoid joining congregations not only because of what I mentioned earlier about having difficult experiences, but also because there's a concern it will confine them somehow to a narrow belief system rather than expand their faith horizon. Or they think their beliefs may not be strong enough rather than relying on simple faith in God's grace alone, as Paul reminds us today, which prefers our humility over our certainty, living out our questions together rather than imposing our answers, striving for communal peace with one another over personal comfort, valuing freedom over restriction, listening over speaking, love over law, diverse, wonderful unity over narrow uniformity, grace over perfection, and hospitality over exclusivity. These are the things that I have experienced right here at First Christian Church through this amazing congregation, and I've been changed by it and have grown from it. And it is alive and well in many faith communities everywhere, even as we know we're not perfect and we've never fully arrived. But it is this wonderful meandering journey that we get to walk together. It does require risk, and sometimes there's disappointment. Trusting when we can't always see the road ahead and leaning on one another becomes part of that journey. Coming together even when we feel the most apart. Praying together when we fall back solely relying on ourselves. But most of all, at least in my mind, it requires and encourages us to remember to come together, to be together in Christ, reminding us that we are one body. This is the gift of the church universal and the life offered in communities of faith like First Christian Church. If you are not part of a faith community, I invite you to pray and to consider if God might be calling you to join a family of faith as a grateful response in remembering Christ and one another. We would love here at First Christian Church to grow in every way from your presence with us right here. Hope you will consider this. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we prepare to gather around the table, I know it's different today because we each have our own communion pods and can't be passing the trays, but we gather here in spirit, remembering that it is God in Christ that sets us free by gathering us together and sending us out so that the world might see us as one and believe that God's love is possible in Jesus Christ. Let us come to the table today, celebrating this gift of Christ gathering us here to remind us every week the significance and the importance and the gift of Christian community, not only for our own lives, but for our families and for the world. We remember this gift even as we remember Jesus' words that he shared on the night before he died for each one of us. He took bread, and after giving thanks, he blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, even as we receive it now, saying, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat and remember me." And as supper was ending, Jesus took the cup, and after giving God thanks, he said, "This is my lifeblood of the new covenant poured out for you and for the world for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as we share in this meal together, we proclaim Christ's everlasting love and presence that goes with us and unifies us in every age. Will you pray with me? O Holy God, pour out your Spirit upon us gathering across our community and in this sanctuary. Pour out your Spirit upon this meal. As we eat and drink and fellowship with each other, may we be filled with hope and wisdom for the future. Bless each of us and this bread and cup we share, so we may be open to your abiding presence, nourished by your unconditional grace, and sent forth strengthened by your love in Christ to bring healing and peace and mercy to your world. Amen. So won't you join me, those here in the sanctuary and online, let us join together in sharing the body of Christ. The bread of life. The cup of salvation. Will you join me in prayer? O gracious God, pour out your Spirit upon this gathering of many into one body. As we eat and drink in fellowship with each other, may we be filled with hope for the future. May the Spirit which binds our hearts to one another enable this meal to renew and empower us to live your love in the world as we go from this place. Amen. If you are someone who's interested in learning more about becoming a member of First Christian Church, feel free to contact us by our email, which is listed on our Facebook page and our website, fccville.org, or you can call the church office at 362-4812. I would be delighted to sit down and have a conversation with you and to meet you in person and hear your story. Just a reminder to those in the sanctuary today before we exit, if you would start from this side and the west side and exit out one at a time with your 6-foot distance, I look forward to greeting you outside where it's nice and airy and we can gather and maybe talk with one another there. As we head forth into this week, as we celebrated over this weekend the freedom that we share, may we be reminded of the true freedom that comes from the grace of God and the peace of Christ and the unity of the Spirit that makes us one and sends us out. Amen. I look forward to seeing you next week. For those here in the sanctuary, hope you will join us again. And for those online, hope to see you next week, this same time at 10:15. Hope you all have a great week. Amen.